Hi everybody, today's video is going to be a little different. I'm going to be reading out loud a part of The Hate List by Jennifer Brown. This is one of my favorite books of all time. I love to read. Sure, some of you know that. If you don't, then I love to read. This is a very interesting book. This is about a couple who initiated a school shooting, and the boyfriend killed himself and the girlfriend, Valerie. The boy's name is Nick. Valerie is going through life without him, and we're going to see how she goes on. I'm not reading this whole entire book today, but it's a lot, honestly. So, if you guys like this, I'll do a series of this book. Let's just jump right into it. There's a part, like news, I'm not gonna read the news first, okay. After I ignored the third snooze alarm, my mom started pounding on my door, trying to get me out of bed, just like any other morning. Only this morning wasn't just any other morning. This was the morning I was supposed to pick myself up and get on with my life. But I guess when moms, old habits die hard. If the snooze alarm doesn't do the trick, you start pounding and yelling whatever kind of morning it is. True. Instead of just yelling at me though, she started getting that scared, quavery sound in her voice that she's had so often lately. The one that said she wasn't sure if I was just being difficult or if she should be ready to call 911. Valerie, she kept pleading, you have to get up now. The school is being very lenient letting you back in. Don't blow it your first day back. Like I was happy about going back to school, about stepping back into those haunted halls. Into the commons, where the world as I knew it had crashed into an end last May. Like I haven't been having nightmares about that place every single night, and waking up sweaty, crying, totally relieved to be in my room again where things were safe. The school couldn't decide if I was hero or villain, and I guess I couldn't blame them. I was having a hard time deciding that myself. Was I the bad guy who set into motion the plan to mow down halfway school? Or the hero who sacrificed herself to end the killing. Some days I felt like both. Some days I felt like neither. It was also complicated. School board did try to hold some ceremony for me early in the summer, which was crazy. I didn't need to be a hero. I wasn't even thinking when I jumped between Nick and Jessica. It's certainly not like I thought. Here's my chance to save the girl who used to call me Sister Death and get myself shot in the process. By all accounts, it was a heroic thing to do, but in my case, well, nobody was really sure. I refused to go to the ceremony, told mom my leg was hurting too much, and I needed some sleep. And besides, it was a stupid idea anyway. It was just like the school I told her to do something totally lame like that. I wouldn't go to something so dumb if you paid me, I said. But the truth was, I was scared of going to the ceremony. I was scared of facing all those people. Afraid they all believed everything they read about me in a newspaper and seen about me on TV, that I've been a murderer, that I see it in their eyes. You should have committed suicide just like him, even if they didn't say it out loud. Or worse, that they made me out to be someone brave and selfless, which will only make me feel more awful than I already did. Given that it was my boyfriend who killed all those kids, and apparently I made him think I wanted him dead too. Not to mention I was the idiot who had no idea that the guy I loved was going to shoot up the school, even though he basically told me so like every day. But every time I opened my mouth to tell mom those things, all that came out was, it's so lame. I wouldn't go to something so dumb if you pay me. Guess old habits die for everyone. Mr. Angerson, the principal, ended coming to our house that night instead. He sat at my kitchen table and talked to my mom about, I don't know, God, destiny, trauma, whatever. Waiting around, I'm sure, for me to come out of my room and smile and tell him how proud I was in my school and how I was more than happy to serve as a human sacrifice for Miss Perfect Jessica Campbell. Maybe he was waiting for me to apologize too, which I would do if I could figure out how. But so far, I hadn't come up with words big enough for something this hard. When Mr. Angerson was in the kitchen waiting for me, I turned up my music and crawled deeper in my sheets and let him sit there. I never came out, not even when my mom started pounding on the door, begging in company voice for me to be polite and come downstairs. Valerie, please, she hissed, opening the door a crack and poking her head into my room. I didn't answer. I pulled the sheets over my head instead. It's not that I didn't want to do it, it's that I just couldn't. But Mom would never understand that. The way she saw it, the more people who forgave me, the less I have to feel guilty about. The way I saw it was just the opposite. After a while, I saw headlights reflecting off my bedroom window. I sat up and looked into the driveway. Mr. Anderson was pulling away. A few minutes later, Mom knocked at my door. "What?" I said. She opened the door and came in, looking all tentative, like a baby deer or something. Her face was all red and splotchy, and her nose was seriously plugged up. She was holding this dorky medal in her hand, a awful letter of thanks from the school district. "They don't blame you," she said. "They want you to know that. They want you to come back. They're very appreciative of what you did." She shoved the medal and letter into my hands. I glanced at the letter and noticed that only about 10 teachers had signed it. Noticed that, of course, Mr. Klein wasn't one of them. For about the millionth time since the shooting, I felt an enormous pain and guilt. Klein was exactly the kind of teacher who would have signed that letter, but he couldn't because he was dead. We stared at each other for a minute. I knew my mom was looking for some sort of gratitude from me.
Sorry, I got a phone call.
Where was I? Oh, some sense that if the school was moving on, maybe I could too. Maybe we all could. Yeah, Mom, I said. I handed the letter and medal to her. That's some great. I tried to muster up a smile to reassure her, but found that I couldn't do it. What if I didn't want to move on just yet? What if that medal reminded me that the guy I trusted most in this world shot people, shot me, shot himself? Why couldn't she see that accepting the school's thanks and that late was painful to me? Like, gratitude would be the only possible emotion I could feel now. Gratitude that I lived. Gratitude that I've been forgiven. Gratitude that they recognized that I'd saved the lives of other garbage students. The truth was, most days I couldn't feel grateful no matter how hard I tried. Most days I couldn't even pinpoint how I felt. Sometimes sad, sometimes relieved, sometimes confused, sometimes misunderstood, and a lot of times angry. And what's worse, I didn't know who I was angry at the most. Myself, Nick, my parents, the school, the whole world. And then there was the anger that felt the worst of all. Anger at the students who died. "Val," she said, her eyes bleeding. "No, really," I said. "It's cool. I'm just really tired as all, Mom. Really, my leg." I pushed my head deeper into my pillow and folded myself into the blankets again. Mom bowed her head and left the room, stooped. I knew she'd try to get Dr. Healer all worked up over my reaction at our next visit. I could imagine him sitting in his chair. "So, Val, you probably talk about that medal." I know Mom later put the medal and letter away in a keepsake box with all the other kid junk she collected over the years. Kindergarten artwork, 7th grade report cards, a letter from the school thanking me for stopping a school shooting. To Mom, somehow all those things were put together. That's Mom's way of showing me her stubborn hope. Her hope that someday I'll be fine again. Although she probably can't remember the last time it was fun. Come to think of it, neither can I. Was it before the shooting? Before Jeremy wanted to Nick's life? Before Mom and Dad started hating each other? And I started searching for someone? Something to take me away from unhappiness. Way back when I had braces and wore a pastel colored sweater and was at top 40 and thought life would be easy? The snooze alarm sounded again and I pawed at it, accidentally knocking the clock to the floor. "Valerie, come on," she yelled. I imagined she had the cordless in her hand by now, her finger poised over the 9. "School starts in an hour, wake up." I curled up around my pillow and stared at the horses printed on my wallpaper. Ever since I was a little kid, every time I got into trouble, I lie on my bed and stare at those horses and imagine myself hopping on one of them and riding away. Just riding, riding, riding. My hair swimming up behind me. My horse never getting tired or hungry. Never finding another soul on earth. Just open possibility ahead of me into eternity. Now the horses just look like crappy kids' wallpaper art. They didn't take me anywhere. They couldn't. Now I knew they never could. Which I thought was so sad. Like my whole life was all a big, dumb dream. I heard clicky against the doorknob and groaned. Of course, the key. At some point, Dr. Healer, usually totally on my side, gave my mom permission to use the key and come into my room whenever she pleased. Just in case, you know. As a precaution, you know. There's a whole suicide issue, you know. So now anytime I didn't answer her knock, she'd just come in right in anyway. The cordless in her hand. just in case she walked in and I was lying in a pool of razor blades and blood and my daily shake to roll up. I watched the doorknob turn. Nothing I could do about it but watch from my pillow. She crept in. I was right. The quarter was in her hand. "Good, you're awake," she said. She smiled and bustled over to the window. She reached up and pulled the blinds open. I squinted against the early morning sunlight. "You're in a suit," I said, shading my eyes with my forearm. She reached down with her free hand and smoothed the camel-colored skirt over her thighs. It was tentative, like it was the first time she'd ever dressed up before. For a minute, she looked as insecure as I was, which made me feel sad for her. "Yeah," she said, using the same hand to pat the back of her hair. "I figure since you're going back to school, I should, you know, start trying to get back full-time at the office." I pulled myself to a sitting position. My head felt sore and flat in the back from lying down so long, and my leg twinged a little. I absently rubbed the dent in my thigh under the sheets. On my first day back, she stumbled over to me, high-stepping over a pile of dirty laundry in her camel-colored heels. "Well, yeah, it's been a few months. Dr. Healer thinks it's fine for me to go back, and I'll be there to pick you up after school." She sat on the side of my bed and stroked my hair. "You'll be fine." "How can you be so sure?" I asked. "How do you know I'll be all right? You can't know. I wasn't okay last night and you didn't know that." I pulled myself out of bed. My chest felt tight and I wasn't sure I wasn't going to cry. She sat, gripping the cordless in front of her. "I just know, Valerie, that thing will ever happen again, honey. Nix. He's gone. Now try not to get all upset." Too late. I was already upset. The longer she sat on the side of my bed and stroked my hair the way she used to do when I was little, and I smelled the perfume that I thought of her work perfume, the more real it was. I was going back to school. "We all agreed this was the best, Valerie, remember?" she said. "Sitting at Dr. Hill's office, we decided running away was not a good option for our family. You agreed. You said that you didn't want Frankie to have to suffer because of what happened, and your dad has his firm. No, leave that. And to start all over again would be so tough for us financially," she shrugged, shaking her head. "Mom," I said, but I couldn't think of a great argument. She was right. I'd have been the one saying that Frankie shouldn't have to leave his friends, that just because he was my little brother didn't mean he should have to change towns, change schools. That Dad, whose jaw tightened angrily every time someone brought up the possibility of our family having to move to a new town, shouldn't have to build a new law firm out there still working hard to build his. That I shouldn't have to be stuck in my house with a tutor, or worse, switch to a new school my senior year. That I'd be damned if I slink away like a criminal when I've done nothing wrong. "It's not like everybody in the whole world doesn't know who I am anyway," I said, running my fingertips along the arm of Dr. Healer's couch. "It's not like I could find a school where nobody has heard of me. Can you imagine how much of an outcast I'd be at a new school? At least at Garvin, I know what to expect. Plus, if I ran away from Garvin, everyone there would even be more sure I was guilty." "It'll be tough," Dr. Healer, I warned. "You're going to have to face a lot of dragons." I shrugged. "What else is new? I can handle them." "Are you sure?" Dr. Healer asked. His eyes narrowed at me skeptically. I nodded. "It's not fair that I should have to leave. I can do this. If it's terrible, I could always transfer at the end of the semester. But I'll make it. I'm not afraid." But that was back when summer stretched in front of us, and possibly long. Back when going back was just an idea, not a reality. As an idea, I still believed in it. I wasn't guilty of anything except loving Nick and hating the people who tormented us. And there was no way I slid her away and hide from the people who believed I was guilty of something else. But now that it came down to putting my idea to practice, I wasn't just afraid. I was terrified. "You had all summer to change your mind," Mom said, still sitting on my bed. I snapped my mouth shut and turned to my dresser. I grabbed a pair of clean underwear and a bra. I scavenged the floor for some jeans and a t-shirt. "Fine, I'll get ready," I said. I can't say that she smiled just then. She did something that was kind of like a smile, only it looked a little painful. She took a couple false starts toward the door, then apparently decided it was a good decision and headed for it completely, gripping the phone in both hands. I wondered if she accidentally taped the phone with her to work. Thumbs to poison with a 9. "Good, I'll wait for you downstairs." I dressed, pulling on the wrinkled jeans and t-shirt hazardly, not even caring what they look like. It's not like dressing them was going to make me feel any better or any less conspicuous. I hobbled into the bathroom and ran a brush through my hair, which I had been washing about 4 days. I didn't bother with makeup either. didn't even really know where it was. It's not like I've been to a lot of cotillions, sorry, over something. For most of that time, I couldn't even walk. I slipped on a pair of canvas shoes and grabbed my backpack, and knowing that mom had bought a few days ago, and that I sat empty in the very place she left it until she finally came in and stuffed it with supplies herself. The old backpack, the bloody one, well, that probably ended up in the garbage, along with Nick's floggy Molly t-shirt, which she found in my closet and thrown away while I was stuck in the hospital. I cried and called her a bitch when I got home and saw if the shirt was missing. She totally didn't get it. That shirt didn't belong to Nick the murderer. It belonged to Nick, the guy who surprised me with flogging Molly tickets when they came to the closet. Nick, the guy who let me climb up on his shoulders while they seen factory girls. Nick, the guy who had the idea that we would pull our money to buy one t-shirt and share it. Nick, the guy who wore the shirt home and then took it off and gave it to me and then never asked for it back. She claimed that throwing the shirt away was advised from Dr. Healer too, but I didn't believe him. Sometimes I had a feeling she just blamed all her ideas on him, so I rolled with it. Dr. Healer would understand that Nick the murderer didn't own that shirt. I didn't even know who Nick the murderer was. Dr. Healer understood that. All dressed, I was struck with a sensation of being too nervous to go through with it. My legs felt almost too weak to take me out the door, and a leg holding a sweat covered the back of my neck. I just couldn't go. I couldn't face those people, those places. I just wasn't strong enough. With shaking hands, I fumbled my cell phone out of my pocket and dialed Dr. Hilo's telephone number. He answered the first ring. "Sorry to bother you," I said, sinking down onto my bed. "No, I told you to call, remember? I was waiting for it." "I don't think I could do this," I said. "I'm not ready. I don't think I'll ever be ready. I think it was a bad idea too." "Valerie, stop," he interrupted. "You can do this. You're ready. We talked this through. It's going to be tough, but you can handle it. You've handled a lot worse over the past several months, right? You're very strong." Tears sprang into my eyes and I wiped them off with my thumb. "Just concentrate on being in the moment," he said. "Don't read into things. See what's really there, okay? When you get home this afternoon, call me. I'll have Stephanie patch you through even if I'm in session, okay?" "Okay. And if you need to talk during the day, I know I can call." "And remember what we said. Even if you make it through only half the day, it's already a victory, right?" "Mom's going back to work all day." "That's because she believes in you, but she'll come home if you need her. My prediction is you won't though, and you know I'm always right." There was a smile in his voice. I chuckled, sniffed, wiped my eyes again. "Right, whatever, I've gotta go." "You're going to do great." "I hope so. I know so. I remember what we said. You can always transfer after this semester if it doesn't work out. That's what, 75 days or so?" "83, I said. "See? Piece of cake. You got this. Call me later. I will." I hung up and picked up my backpack. I started to walk up the door but stopped. There was something missing. I reached under my top dresser drawer and fumbled around until I found it, tucked into the frame of my drawer, out of mom's investigative reach. I pulled it out and looked at it for about the millionth time. It was a photo of Nick and me at Blue Lake on the last day of school, sophomore year. He was holding a beer and I was laughing so hard, I swear he seemed my tonsils in that picture. We were sitting on a giant rock right next to the lake. I think it was Mason who took that picture. I couldn't remember for the life of me what was so funny. No matter how many nights I stayed awake trying to drum it up. We looked so happy, and we were. No matter what the emails and suicide notes and the hate list said, we were happy. I touched the laughing still shot on Nick's face with my finger. I could still hear his voice loud and clear. Still hear him asking me on a serious Nick way, at once bold and angry and romantic and shy. "A vow," he had said, pulling himself off the rock and bending to pick up his beer bottle. He picked up a flat rock with his free hand and took a few steps forward and skipped it across the lake. It skipped once, twice, three times before it dove into the water and stayed. Stacy laughed from somewhere nearby in the woods. Deuce laughed just after her. It was getting into night when a frog started croaking somewhere to my left. "Do you ever think about just leaving it all behind?" I pulled my heels up against the rock and grabbed my knees. I thought about mom and dad's fight the night before, about mom's voice dripping up the stairs from the living room, the words unclear, but the tone venomous. About dad leaving the house around midnight, the door shutting softly behind him. "You mean like run away?" "Definitely." Nick was silent for a long time. He picked up another rock and slung it across the lake. It skipped twice and fell. "Sure," he said, "or you know, like driving off a cliff and never looking back." I stared at the setting sun and thought about it. "Yeah," I said, "everybody does. It's only Thelma and Louie. turned and kind of laughed, disfilled the last of his beer, and dropped the bottle to the ground. Never saw it, he said. Then, remember where we read Romeo and Juliet in freshman English last year? Yes. He leaned over me. You think we could be like them? I crinkled my nose. I don't know, I guess, sure. He turned again and stared out into the lake. Yeah, we could. We really could. We think alike. I stood up and brushed the back of my dags, which felt dimply from the texture of the rock we were sitting on. Are you asking me out? He turned, lurched toward me, and grabbed me around the waist. He picked me up until my feet were dangling above the ground. I couldn't help it. I let out a squeal that turned to a giggle. He kissed me and my body felt so electric up against his. Even my toes tingled. It seemed like forever that I'd been waiting for him to do this. Would you say no if I did? He asked. Hell no, Romeo, I said. I kissed him back. Did I guess I am, Juliet? He said. And I swear as I touch his face in the photo, I could hear it again. Could feel him in the room with me.
Got her phone call.
Even though I may, he became a monster in the eyes of the world. In my eyes, he was still that guy holding me above the ground, kissing me and calling me Juliet. I stuffed the photo into my back pocket. 83 and counting, I said out loud, taking a deep breath and heading downstairs. Okay, that was the first chapter of the book. And I hope you guys enjoyed the first chapter. If this is something you like, I can make it to a series, just put in the comments if you like it, okay?